Good morning, everybody. Just before going into that, just telling about me. I work for Fujitsu Australia Software Technology. I am a member of a team which develops Fujitsu Enterprise Postgres, and I have around 9+ years of experience in developing database technologies. These are the contents which we are going to discuss today. It's a little bit big, but I have tried my level best to shorten it up. So I can go through that rest of the things later. So introduction, before going to the things, we at Fujitsu are working mainly to provide analytical and enterprise capabilities to PostgreSQL. So the in-memory column store is one of the outcome of the analytical study done by Fujitsu Laboratories. So Fujitsu Laboratories database team has designed and developed this analytical columnar storage. Yeah, maybe all of you may be mostly aware that what is the need of column store and why it is, but just going through that is mainly for using large data sets where the unwanted data is read and discarded. Because of that reason, the time is taking more. So to avoid that, on large data sets, we are going with columnar storage. And one more advantage with columnar storage is the compression efficiency, as because we are storing all the same kind of columns into one place, so the compression will be better compared to the row-wise. And need of in-memory, as in most of you aware that in-memory approach like Postgres supports with shared buffers. So with shared buffers, we are able to achieve the in-memory capabilities if you have a very big good RAM. So where you can store entire tables in the shared buffers and you can access it. Here, why we are saying as in-memory column store is because we want to do transactional plus analytical in one database. So that time, how we'll achieve the column store with in-memory. That we will explain. So this is the overview of the architecture, how the columnar storage was designed. So if you see the normal operations, any normal insert or update or delete, which will directly go through the normal flow, and it is implemented with an index approach. Like if you want a columnar storage on particular columns, you can create an index on those columns. Those columns will be kept as separate with the columnar storage. So the inserted records will be saved into a different relation, which is called write optimized storage, and then moved into a read optimized storage. For both, we don't want to lose the performance because of columnar stores for inserts and updates. So, and the select query, how we achieve the performance here is we used a custom plan as of now to use the columnar storage. So use the custom plan to implement the scan, sort, and aggregate. So there it uses the VCI, the index columnar storage, to fetch the results and improve the performance. This columnar storage is implemented with an extension with minimal changes in the backend. And this needs to be loaded as a shared preload libraries. It is a new index method which is added, which is called vertical clustered index. The name of the which was given to this VCI is a vertical clustered index. User needs to create this index on the columns where he wants the columnar to be present. Yeah, to support proper columnar storage without affecting the write performance and providing a good read capabilities, we divided into a two kind of storage. One is write optimized storage, another one is read optimized storage. So the write optimized storage is a temporary place where the columns which are part of the vertical clustered index are stored as a row-wise format, same as normal how it stores. And later, it will be moved to the read optimized storage periodically. And to support this behavior of two kinds of storage, we created internally many internal relations to store these informations. Going into the write optimized storage, in the write optimized storage, we have the mainly stores the raw data format of the indexed columns, the vertical clustered indexed columns. There we have two kinds of main relations. One is data OS and whiteout OS. So here the WOS is main responsible for MVCC behavior, because to make it simpler, so there is no transaction information that is available in the ROS. Read optimized storage, there is no transaction information, like whatever data present in ROS is visible to everyone. Every transaction is visible. So these are the some of the how the page will be stored regarding the WOS and WhiteOS, whiteout OS, WOS. The it stores the TID, because as it is implemented with an indexed approach, so it stores the original table where the TID and the heap tuple data. Heap tuple data is the columns where which are part of the index. Whereas whiteout is just to store the deleted data. So it doesn't need to store whatever is, if the deleted data of the rows which are present in ROS. Means if I delete any record which is present in ROS, to store that information, I will store it presently in the double whiteout OS. Maybe if the transaction rolls back, we'll just clean it up. Instead of touching the ROS, we'll just store the information in whiteout OS. Tuples which don't have the multiple copies, that means which are frozen, those will be periodically moved to the ROS, where it is simpler way of handling ROS. Because of that reason, we took this approach. What is read optimized storage? Mainly in this read optimized storage, we will explain the ROS extent and ROS, how the ROS data will be accessed in a columnar format, and how ROS will handle the deleted tables. That information is discussed here. Read optimized storage is the where all the columns are stored in a the vertical indexed columns in a columnar in a separate files. So to create these separate files, we created an internal relations of column store, which are called internal column store relations, which contains each column data. So differently to WOS, ROS is not maintained by TID, which cannot be referred by TID, which is called, we have here, columnar identifier. It's a CRID, columnar record identifier, used to identify a particular record in ROS. So just a CRID is just a combination of extent number and offset. I can just tell you what is extent is just a collection of pages or collection of records, fixed set of records we used here. So it's extent number means, so maybe if there are many number of records in a table, the number of extents will be increased. So just extension is one set of number of records in one extent. The CRID is just a logical position of columnar data, which CRID contains extent number and the offset. The offset again may contain a TID where it can point to a page and the corresponding offset. The CRID, if it is a fixed length data, the CRID can be used directly to refer by just calculating the length of the data and CRID number. You can just divide it, you can directly reach to the page where the data is present. So yeah, this is the an extent, we can say, logical data block in ROS. One extent contains 26,2114 records in an extent. It's a logical collection of data records. Every column can change, can have many number of, based on the size, it can have many. It's like here, if you see the column A, extent size may be 10 pages, whereas column B, it can go to 20 pages. It's based on the size, how it stores, but it's a fixed number of records in an extent. So if every means the pages in an extent may change, but the number of records in extents are fixed. This we used for easier approach of handling the data in ROS. Everything in ROS, it is performed with like WS to ROS is based on the extent level. So once the data is ready in WS, which is frozen, means all transactions that are can see the data, those data will be moved periodically by a ROS to WS to ROS launcher, which can data movement, which will do that periodically by checking the data, which is all visible to everyone. So this CRID is just a continuous number, just like an extent number, and in that it's just a continuous set of records, like 12262144, it's just a number. Yeah, this is the format of internally how an extent will be, the data will be saved here. So the first is the number of records, the variable which stores how many number of records is present in an extent, and the offset of those extents, and the followed by the last, the data. So that whenever it needs an, this is just a one extent header page. This contains the information of the number of offsets and followed by the data. The data will be on any number of pages. So whenever the data is getting inserted, the new pages will be allocated to the extent, and it will be keep on added. So the entry of that offset will be filled in this extent header. So from this extent header, we can directly go to the position where we can refer the data. Yeah, in the format of this offset is mainly PostgreSQL is having toasted data. So wherever, whenever the record size is, the columnar size is big, it will toast it and place it in a different toast table and stores the toast pointer here. So we want to use that capabilities also here. So to represent whether it is the real data or just raw data or the external toast, we have used two bits in the offset. In the that CRID offset, we use two bits to represent whether it is the raw data or toasted data. So while retrieving the data from columnar, from the CRID, we'll refer this offset based on this, we'll refer the data. So this is the way how the internal relations are mapped with how it will be accessed. The main relation is the, whenever you create an index, index will create the main relation, index relation. But internally we create many relations like column metadata and column data. So column metadata is for every column and column data is for every column. So like that we'll have, if you have two columns, then we'll have four extra relations we'll create. And extra we have TAD, CRID maps to represent from TAD, how can I directly go into a CRID? So there is another relation which will have the mapping between TRID and CRID. So whenever if you have a TAD, just we'll refer to the TAD and CRID map, from there directly go to the extent, get the data of ROS which you want. Yeah, for fixed column length data types, the compressed or any raw data type, it's just the from the CRID, by calculating the length, we can directly go to the position where my data is present. Because the size, because extent is a fixed number of records, so the record size is also fixed, so we can directly point from the location of the data starts to the number where the exactly the data is present. It's the easiest way of calculating if it is a fixed length, but if it is a variable length, directly go to the offset and get the offset location, the data, where it resides in a page again. The data is just a page and TAD, something like TAD, it contains in the offset. From there you can go to the page and read the data. Yeah, ROS delete vector is mainly, if you have a data, already most of the data is present in ROS and you try to delete a record in ROS. Because just for deleting some records in ROS, it is not good to go and touch and delete the records in ROS. So instead of that, we'll maintain a small array kind of thing, which is bit vector to represent what type in an extent. This is also as a, per extent, these also will be stored. So we have fixed number of records, so 262144. So we have this one bit for every field in that. So when this bit is set, that means the corresponding record is deleted. So instead of going and modifying the data in ROS, touching the ROS, whenever if you really need to touch ROS data during the transformation from WS to ROS, we'll just update this bit. So this will tell the record is deleted in the ROS. And usually after some, if many number of records are deleted, you will delete the corresponding information and place it all the live records into another extent for easier maintenance. Yeah, this is all this garbage collection of copying the live data to an extent, and this information is maintained by ROS daemon, which we will call like WS to ROS daemon process. It periodically moves the data from WS to ROS, moves the white WS, means which are deleted records that are present, to a delete vector, and it does the cleanup also, garbage cleaning also. So the main, this process, it works like a launcher or auto vacuum launcher. It generates processes which will do these operations. Yeah, this is the example of how the data will be, garbage cleanup will happen. So the first, whenever the, when all the deleted vector data is collected, so maybe I have one extent. An extent contains many data tuples in that. So instead of keeping that extent, it will just allocate another location where the data and copies all the live data to that place and reclaim this entire space. So this will be whenever any access, any query is accessing the data, this will not be carried out. Once the no queries are present, this will be done, this garbage cleanup. Yeah, data movement from WS to ROS, it's a background worker which does these operations like WS to ROS conversion, update delete vector, collect deleted rows in an extent, because this is required to convert the, for garbage collection, and update TAD-CRID relation. This is TAD-CRID is to find out the data which is present in main relation to the data present in columnar store. Yeah, this is just an SQL operations, how it happens. So if you do insert or delete, if you do an insert, first it will insert into your data into a WS relation only, like column A, column B, column C in a row-wise format. Once it is frozen, then only it will be transferred to the ROS. Till that time, it is present in the WS relation. Like a normal index, how the normal index will contain, the same way it is there. If you delete that, if the data is present in, 2 is present in, like it's there in ROS, so that will be marked as invisible in whiteout WS relation. Means if any data that is present in ROS is deleted, that information is stored in whiteout WS relation without touching the ROS. So no SQL query will touch the ROS until unless the background worker which does these operations like ROS daemon. No, how it happens is whenever any select query is fired, the data which is present in WS is converted as a local ROS into that backend and reads the full data. So while reading from WS using the bitmap bit delete vector, it finds out what are the deleted in the ROS, and from the whiteout OS relation, it finds out what is the deleted record. So and if and the select next select will fetch the data, converting this WS to a local ROS and fetch the data. Yeah, maybe this is the a simple way of explaining that one. Like if I do an insert, so it stores into a WS by writing the data into a wall. If I am doing a scan, the same WS is converted to a local ROS in the particular backend in the shared memory. So why we are using shared memory is because we want to use parallel workers. So in case if we want to use parallel workers for faster data access, so we use the local ROS also in the shared memory. And in the asynchronous way, first we'll delete in the WS and then move the data into ROS. Yeah, during the scan time, because we have to read the what are visible to this transaction data. So to do this, we use create a local ROS. The local ROS is the which will a transaction scan that is applied on WOS data and frames the local ROS with extent number as -1. From -1, it goes back to which based on the how many records are present in WOS. If there are more records present in WOS, we are skipping the scan because as it costs more to do a local ROS generation and then do a scan. Yeah, mainly we want to go with in-memory approach. Why we need in-memory approach rather than we already have a shared buffers and things. Mainly because we want to use a mixed kind of load, like where OLTP plus OLAP applications are running on the same database. So the OLTP applications are running very regularly compared to the OLAP applications. So in that case, the shared buffers logic which Postgres currently have will replace all the unused buffers with the recently using data buffers. So in that case, later if I fire a OLAP query, all the ROS pages which belongs to a column store are not present in the shared buffers. That may lead to a problem like where it takes time to load those pages into the shared buffers and to process the query. So to avoid this, so we are just thinking of using some kind of a reserving area for shared buffers for in-memory columnar store tables. So this is just a concept we haven't yet implemented, just thinking of using this like stable buffer approach. Whenever you're creating a index, we'll just mention it as use a stable buffer approach. So that means if I have a thing like I have some 10 GB of shared buffers, I want to reserve 7 GB for columnar tables. So that 7 GB is only used for columnar tables. The rest of the 3 GB only will be recycled whenever the OLTP applications are performing. So these 7 GB pages will not be touched. So in that case, the query which are coming for OLAP, they have most of the times the pages will be available in memory. Yeah, like in-memory tables.
Shared memory will be allocated as dynamically. So will that be something useful in this case?
Yeah, I heard that like in-memory table approach, whenever in-memory table is created, fix the size of dynamic shared memory.
Yeah.
Yes, it can be useful, but yeah, as of now we have things like shared buffers are available, so yeah, just using this approach. Yeah, maybe we'll think of that one also. Yeah, to do this, we are just thinking of using a reserve buffer ratio approach, like a new GUC. So telling like how much ratio we want to reserve for in-memory columnar tables. So based on that, it will, by using some kind of a counter or by referring a tag, a buffer tag, so this page is used for columnar store relation compared to a normal buffer. By incrementing some counter. So whenever that counter crosses a specified range, then any page can be replaced. Before that, the pages which are used by in-memory column store cannot be reclaimed by any other process. Yeah, this is the performance data which we collected after implementing this VCI index. So we found that in many places the VCI has improved the performance compared to the other commercial databases. So this is the DB3 query test which we have carried out on the VCI index. I didn't mention the names of the other databases. So yeah, in that test we found that the VCI has improved performance very well, and it gave good performance compared to the other commercial databases in 4 queries, but it is significantly improved in other queries also. So this is the comparison ratio, like how many times it improved the performance by using the VCI index. So we found that it is coming as around 6 times improvement using VCI on DB3 queries. Yeah, but the leader is commercial database, which is coming as 10, but still, which with VCI, maybe we have to add more vectorization functionalities into the VCI, then it may improve. Okay, this is just a prototype, and we developed with custom plan interface. Yeah, the current state of the patch is right now it was implemented with an index access method approach. All the storage area part is completed, and with custom plan, we generated the plans to use the VCI index. And as because it's currently under VCI index access methods, we have some workarounds for vacuum and hot updates. So maybe those will be removed once we are trying to integrate with the second quadrant has proposed some new way of syntax to create the columnar storage. So we are thinking how the storage engine will be fit into that area. So based on that, it will be further changed. And as of now, we don't have a proper planner changes for this approach. Only we have done storage and the custom plan changes to do the planner. And we have added our own vectorization operations for aggregate and scan sort for improving, including parallelism. In this, how we choose the parallelism is instead of file by file, we use an extent based approach. Like extent by extent, we'll do a scan compared to the page by page approach which is available. Why you chosen that approach is if we take like if I have 5 relations, if I give a one relation for one worker, it may not filter out the data at his location. But whereas by maybe combination of C1 plus C2 greater than 10, or if I have like that combination, so the data whichever is read by the worker will be fed back to the leader always without filtering. In parallel scan, what I observed is the data transfer cost is more compared to the sequence cost. Like scanning in multiple workers is not that costly than data transfer. So that's the reason only right now the parallel scan can give up to 20% selectivity or something. More than that, if you go, it doesn't give good performance because of the data transfer cost that involves from worker to leader transformation. So that's why we are trying to use the extent-based approach where we can filter out most of the conditions in the worker itself and then transfer the data.
You said you use the index access method?
Yes.
How well does that fit what you need? Like, is it really awkward for you, or does it fit fairly well naturally with your the types of
It's except for heart update, it's everything is useful for us. Only for heart updates we have done some extra hooks. Other than that, index access method can give most of the informations. So that's why the only very limited two hooks only we have added. Other than that, everything is index access method will give us. Not yet. I didn't yet send. We have to prepare and send the patch. We are planning to send. But as of now, only storage is ready. But with custom plan, we implemented to test the performance. But for community, maybe we can just as of now, I can send the storage part as a patch. But and including, I have to integrate with the new proposed syntax by second quadrant. Yeah, maybe before that, I will share the patch and then I can integrate it. Yeah, it's a single node thing as of now.
I forgot to mention, it's good if you repeat the questions because it's a bit late now, but there's no audience microphone.
Oh.
Okay. What are you doing from a compression standpoint on the column store, either in the write optimized or read optimized store?
In write optimized storage, okay, yeah. The question is what we are doing at regarding compression in the write optimized storage. Write optimized storage. We have a called dictionaries we'll create for every extent. And extent based in the extent or the based on the number of records, it will be compressed and stores the data. That is also during transformation from WOS to ROS. During that time, it does those operations. Everything, yeah.
Like so in the ROS, it's dictionary
compressed. Yes, everything is in ROS, it is compressed data. If you have enabled the compression, otherwise the plain data will be there, the raw data.
So it's not by default compressed?
It's not by default. You can have, it's an option to the user. User can enable whether he wants a compression or not. Based on that, during the transformation, it takes care of the compression also. Yes, as an index.
We have to still create a table.
Yes.
And column or store will be in the index.
Yes. Yes, similar like SQL Server. I think SQL Server is also having something like column or index. And
so, the WOS that is described, wouldn't that be same as what the underlying table is?
Yes, it is the same, but WS is only for temporary storage data. Means once the data is frozen, the entire data in the WS will be deleted. It will be moved to the ROS storage.
But the rows in the WOS are only the columns that are
in the part of the index.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Only the part of the index. Yeah, but as of now, the copy of the data is present in the physical data relation also. We want to avoid that using the new approach like that. For that, we have to enhance it. So this is just a storage where it can give, whether it can give performance or not, if you go with in columnar storage approach. So just we tried this approach. So it improves around 6 times performance than current PostgreSQL. So we are thinking of.
Is there an impact on OLTP operations, DMLs? Do I pay a penalty on insert?
The question is there any problem for write operations, OLTP operations because of this? It's not very limited impact. It's just like an index creation. Whatever is the extra when you create an index on the table, how much time it takes, the same time it takes for this also. Because the main conversion process and everything is takes care by the background workers. So for the user, it will be very negligible impact. like an index creation approach. We didn't yet test it with very big shared buffers. Yeah, maybe we have to try that. We didn't yet try testing with large shared buffers as of now. So this is just what we tried, is whether it really gives a good performance using a columnar storage in this approach we tried. So now we have to enhance this according to, like, instead of duplicating the data which is there in the data relation plus columnar store, we want to check how we can eliminate the duplication. Those enhancements we have to do. Maybe before that, we can share the current state of the patch, and then we'll further do the development. It's a mainly DB2 and SAP HANA and Oracle are the other commercial databases. Oracle 12c, where in memory and row based both we have tested.
So you didn't compare with SQL Server with the memory
engine? No, SQL Server we didn't compare. Okay. Only DB2, SAP HANA, and Oracle. So. As of now, we cannot say, or maybe Oracle is the leader as of now in the test we found. Yeah, because we saw that some of the readings are like it was less compared to the Postgres by other databases. All the yellow, the marked are less compared to the Postgres in a row-based approach in some databases, commercial databases. Yeah, the question is, do we need to do anything special regarding MVCC? Currently, we don't need to. How we store is the MVCC behavior is present only in the write optimizer storage area. So the records which are present in WOS will have the transaction ID like xmin and xmax informations. So that store, that gives the transaction visibility data there. Once, while any query, the selection is happening, the WOS data is transformed to a local ROS. During the local ROS transformation, what are the data which is visible to the transaction will be transformed to a local ROS, and then the query will be executed. So we are not doing anything specific to MVCC because it's already there in Postgres, so we are just using the WS storage area by storing that in the transforming from WS to local ROS. Will take care of that.
Yeah, I'd just say in general, on the in-memory aspect of things, right? I mean, simply pinning pages in memory with buffers doesn't really give you an in-memory database, right? It gives you a disk-based database where things are. And so if you look at something like SAP HANA, there, you know, an L2 cache miss is treated as essentially a disk IO, right? You get the performance because everything, you know, it tries to minimize cache misses. So there's things like, you know, the actual column arrays of data are highly bit compressed, and then there's vector operations, SIMD operations that happen on. To get to real in-memory database performance, you need to get, there's more than just pinning the.
That's correct. Yes.
It's a lot.
Yes, there is a lot. Yeah, as of now, we are using shared buffers approach currently. So, yeah, maybe further it can be enhanced.
All right.
Thank you.